Thanks to Brilliant for supporting this episode of SciShow. Go to brilliant.org/scishow to learn how you can take your STEM skills to the next level. Obviously, animals wearing outfits are adorable, but researchers all over the world are decking out animals with accessories for plenty of other reasons, all in the name of science. Instead of miniature hats and diamond-studded collars, these researchers are attaching special devices onto various critters to learn more about them, from tracking elusive species' travels and behaviors to even controlling their movements. Here are six ways scientists have used technological trinkets to discover more about animals and the places they live. Pollinators and their plants are in decline around the world. While the primary blame of this pollination loss is likely on humans for removing and fragmenting habitats, it's a challenge to study the specifics of how altering ecosystems may be impacting pollinators. As you can imagine, tracking wee little pollinators is no easy task. For instance, hummingbirds are important pollinators of tropical forest plants in Costa Rica. While they may be some of the teeniest birds around, they still happen to be pretty large compared to other flower visitors. So a 2017 master's thesis investigated what hummingbirds were up to in the face of changing habitats. These researchers used tiny radio frequency identification, or RFID readers, to read transponder tags that they attached to multiple species of hummingbirds to see how they moved through habitats in search of a meal. The studies took place across large tracts of forest, with some sections split up by pasture and by patches of scrub or previously damaged forest that is now regenerating. The researchers left out unlimited food in all of those areas to make sure the amount of food available wasn't skewing results. These tracking studies found that some species didn't mind all that much and were traveling around all the areas, from pasture to healthy forest. But certain species avoided the pastures entirely, and others seemed to avoid the scrub too, sticking only to the healthy interior forest for travel. There are a few possible reasons only some species avoided these areas. There could be a higher risk of predators finding them outside the denser forest. Some of them might even be fearful of encountering more aggressive hummingbirds that would be harder to escape in the open. But more research needs to be done to help us understand these factors. Understanding these movement patterns could help in regeneration efforts and guide how we approach restoring fragmented ecosystems and creating pollinator corridors. And while we're tracking the movement of important pollinators, we might also want to track their predators as well. The Asian yellow-legged hornet is a not-so-welcome introduced species that is spreading around the world and happens to be a predator to our beloved bees. While they're fine to thrive in their own ecosystem, these hornets have been putting European pollinators at risk since their accidental introduction to France around 2004. They've been spreading at a rate of about 70 kilometers a year, even making the jump over to the UK in 2016. The thing is, even though we're trying to keep tabs on them and limit their spread, they're just really tough to track down. Their nests are well hidden, and you can imagine how difficult it is to follow a hornet back to its nest just by watching it. The good news is, these hornets can carry a lot of weight since they are built for carrying bees back home for dinner. So researchers started outfitting them with radio telemetry tags tied around their little waists using cotton thread in order to track them to their nests. Once they released the hornets, they were able to locate their nests within just hours. And these weren't short flights. Some hornets flew over a kilometer back to their homes. Not only is this kind of research helpful for finding nests and trying to stop the spread, but it also allows us to learn a lot about their ecology. New discoveries about their lives might help to better managing their numbers and controlling their invasion outside of their home turf. New Caledonian crows are already pretty notorious for their incredible tool use. They not only use tools to extract food from plant material, they also manufacture different types of tools over different geographical regions, showing a whole new level of sophistication. And while it's been suspected that New Caledonian crows are passing on their tool skills to each other, understanding their social habits could unlock some really interesting information about how this information is shared from crow to crow. In a study that tracked 34 of these clever crows, special receivers were strapped to them using little harnesses. These devices act differently than a typical radio transmitting device in that they also send information out about other nearby tags. This means that they can be used to create maps of social interactions between all tagged crows, including how long they hang out together and how far apart they are, and the results were wild. Over 7 days, these crows logged 28,000 social encounters, These are some seriously extroverted birds. And that showed the researchers they were much more social than your average crow and did a lot of interacting with birds that they weren't even related to. Some of these interactions likely included watching each other use tools, so when it comes to passing along information, it's not just staying in the family. It's no wonder they're so clever. They're chatting up all the other crows around them all the time and watching what each other are up to. The wandering glider dragonfly is an impressive flyer and is known for making its way across entire oceans during migration. Not too shabby for an insect only 5 centimeters long. By studying their incredible flight capabilities, we might become better flyers ourselves by mimicking their flight performance in human-made devices. So researchers accessorized these dragonflies with small loads attached to their undersides to learn more about what makes them such incredible flyers. When these load-bearing insects were dropped mid-air, researchers measured their flight response to the added weight. With this, they were able to estimate the total aerodynamic force on these insects while they were still able to maintain flight. That is, they measured the forces acting on the dragonflies as they fly relative to the air around them. And it's impressive, as these weighed-down dragonflies could handle aerodynamic forces equivalent to 4.3 times their own body weight. For some flying species, we've really only studied their flight performance in terms of lifting off with a load, and not necessarily how their body reacts to recovering after being dropped with extra weight. And in the case of these wandering gliders, they were able to handle a much heavier load through this dropping method compared to earlier studies that measured their takeoff abilities. That means using this method on other species could give us a stronger comparison between their flight performances and performances under different conditions. And this will also help us understand how wing shape, wing flexibility, and other factors are influencing differences in those species' aerial abilities. Which, of course, could be important information for use in engineering applications and future flying machine designs. Next, we head from the air to the sea. You might not be surprised to learn that there are special instruments that we use to measure things like ocean temperature and wind conditions, but thanks to seals, we can take these measurements into very remote locations that we could not otherwise reach. Southern elephant seals cover a lot of area during their months at sea, from the sea ice zone to subtropical waters. They can also dive to incredible depths, reaching as deep as 2,000 meters. These seals hang out in regions where there just isn't a lot of other sampling going on, since they aren't exactly ideal locations for humans to be hanging out. So we get the seals to do the monitoring work for us. While they go about their business, GPS tags and satellite multi-sensors glued to the backs and noggins of seals are recording and sending out all kinds of data, including water temperature, salinity, and pressure. This information helps with the analysis and forecasts of ocean temperature, wave and wind conditions, and even phytoplankton blooms. So we can thank elephant seals for helping us out with more accurate weather predictions and uncovering some mysteries of the oceans for us. Last but not least on our list of great animal accessories, we got the cyborg cockroaches. They're here looking for work, jobs in search and rescue. Okay, maybe making robot-animal hybrids sounds like something out of a science fiction film, but it is not too far from reality. A fancy backpack attached to a cockroach can actually work as a neurocontroller microcircuit. Yes. Brain control. Wires connected to the insect's antenna are used to control the cockroach's movement. We can do this by sending electrical charges through the antenna that trick the roach into believing it has detected an obstacle, causing it to veer in a new direction. Since this device is hooked up to Bluetooth, its signal is very easy to track. All you need is a cell phone. While watching the insect's direction, speed, and other movement information, the electrical charges sent to their antenna are adjusted to steer them into different directions, sending them into areas that we can't easily reach otherwise. This would be a significant advantage if used in search and rescue missions, like inside a collapsed building, to better focus our efforts and find trapped people sooner. Cockroaches can go anywhere, even if they have a fancy little backpack on. We might not see a cockroach coming to our rescue in the immediate future, but this kind of technology is only getting better as we're able to gather more information with smaller and smaller devices. These types of studies are becoming more popular all the time and are helping us expand our knowledge of ecology, physiology, and evolution. With these new studies, we do also have to be careful in how we use them and make sure that they are not negatively impacting the species we're studying. Devices, of course, can change an animal's normal behavior, behavior or even put significant energy demands on them, making it more difficult for them to survive. Ensuring these devices don't impact their daily lives has to remain a major focus of these types of studies moving forward. And the good news is, we are getting really good at it. We've even developed small devices that can be injected with a syringe. That means animals can go about their day none the wiser of the important information they're sending our way. Thanks to these tech accessories, we can learn so much about individual animals, entire populations, and the world around them that would otherwise remain a mystery to us. And if you're the type of person who enjoys learning how we can use science to understand our mysterious world, you might want to check out today's sponsor, Brilliant. Brilliant offers STEM courses that are designed to be hands-on with super interactive quizzes and guided problems with explanations. For example, if you like this episode and would like to learn more about how we can use technology and data to understand biology, you might enjoy the course Computational Biology. This course teaches how computational biology can be used to approach problems from evolutionary relationships to forensics. And if you sign up at brilliant.org/scishow, you'll get 20% off the annual premium subscription. Thanks again for watching this episode of SciShow.